Hello, Myth Junkies, and welcome back, TV Huggers. If you think you know werewolves, leave it at the doggy door. We're hunting for the lore and origins on werewolves, and showcasing the best examples of pop culture throughout video games, movies, and TV shows. If this is your first time here, or you're back and hungry for more, be sure to like this video, subscribe, and share this video with your family and friends. Time is running out, so let's sink our teeth in. As most of us already know, a werewolf is a supernatural creature that starts as a mortal human who gains the ability to shapeshift into a cunning, bloodthirsty, wolf-like animal. This can occur either purposely or through a curse by affliction to the body, such as a bite or scratch from another werewolf. Somewhat like an infection, but one that gives you immense hunger for flesh, heightened senses and speed, and unrelenting power. The name that the infection goes by is lycanthropy. This term has been used within the earliest sources of belief, and I mean as far back as the 11th and 12th century. How do you spot someone affected by lycanthropy? It's fairly simple, guys. If your buddy starts talking crazy about turning into an animal at one point in time, starts howling and clawing, and suddenly looks at you with a hungry stare, run. Don't pet him, don't put a leash on him, take him out for a walk, just run. Luckily enough for us, clinical lycanthropy is very rare, but yes, it does exist as a psychological byproduct of schizophrenia, dementia, and any other disorders that are diagnosed on people who start talking about seeing things and feeling unexplainable things that science can't prove are real. So we discussed the basics of what a werewolf is and its clinical symptoms, but where do they come from? There are many places that we can start, but personally, I would like to start with the story of King Lycaon. According to Ovid and other authors on Greek mythology, King Lycaon was a tyrannical king who one night had a visitor come to his door. This person claimed that they were a god. Laughing in the face of his guests, he decides maybe this is an opportunity to test this claim. He calls to his servants and requests a proper dinner for a god. At his table, King Lycaon sat before this man alongside his own sons, who watched intently as the food was brought forth. The mysterious guest was served this generous offering of food. However, within the contents of this feast was another guest, a man who was roasted and cooked and served on a plate to a god who did not stomach the flesh of other beings, especially humans. In an outrage and absolute disgust, Zeus himself revealed his identity. His thunderous rage over the contemptuous gesture by King Lycaon was so great that Zeus swiftly turned him into a creature that reflected on what King Lycaon resembled in nature, a murderous wolf, cursed with the lack of satisfaction for anything else besides human flesh. King Lycaon killed and devoured his sons and disappeared into the night. Okay, there are definitely numerous versions of the same story, or, you know, slightly different, but also kind of the same. But this was the one that I personally enjoyed, and was the most vicious of its kind. The events that followed is basically Zeus saying, redo, and thus the Greek flood began. The people of the Bronze Age and King Lycaon left such an impression on Zeus that he felt the human race needed a fresh start. I plan on discussing the great floods of ancient mythology, so if you want to get in on that, keep an eye out, and once it's completed, I'll insert a link above. Where else can we find werewolves? From the witch trials, to France, to Norse mythology, countless examples exist within the realm of history and storytelling. The epic tales and influences are numerous and vary between place and time, but all possess recurring details of a monster that can only be described as supernatural due to its size, strength, and hunger. Let's elaborate a little bit, starting with the Beasts of Gévaudan. Between 1764 and 1767 was a true account of a massacre done by a gray wolf who attacked and devoured men, women, and children. All of these done within just a 50-mile radius. Victims were often found with their throats ripped out and partially eaten. Across the French hillside of Marguerite, the Kingdom of France used soldiers, civilians, and royal huntsmen to find and take down the beast. there were 210 attacks total. 113 of those were deaths. During the Salem witch trials, it was told that cunning women who have mastered the art of disguising themselves or riding on the backs of wolves were seen as a form of witchcraft. In Norse mythology, wolves played a huge part as guardians and as powers of destruction. Odin had two wolves of his own, named Geri and Freki, and Fenrir was the demise that Odin faced during Ragnarok. Champion Vikings would wear the furs of wolves to battle and call themselves berserkers. This term was used to describe their trance-like fury from man to wolf, and with this, they conquered their enemies on the battlefield. Alrighty, girls and boys, this is my favorite werewolf. Wolf Link from Zelda Twilight Princess may be one of the more mild versions of werewolves, but it's a game that I played and beat with pride. I absolutely love the Legend of Zelda series, so I may be a tad biased. Transforming into a wolf and roaming the darkness of Hyrule to restore light might be a happy version of an otherwise bloodthirsty monster, but whatever. Who is your favorite werewolf? Be sure to leave me a comment below. Well, that's that. Another video down and many more to go. I apologize for the amount of time it took for me to upload this video, but I assure you that I am still alive and well. Let me know in the comments section what you thought of this video and any special requests you'd like to make. Be sure to like, subscribe, and ring that bell. Once again, thank you for letting Mama break down the mythos.